Now about the dynamics of living a spirit-filled life. I don't know about you, but I believe as we sing about the victor and all that, that Jesus has done an amazing job. How many people believe that Jesus has done an amazing job? He said in his word, he said that he's come to destroy the works of Satan. And I believe that that's what God has done. I want to ask you tonight, I want to ask you today a question. What is normal Christian living? What is normal Christian living? Is normal Christian living going to church, praying, and just living like that? That's not normal Christian living at all. Jesus, if that was so, why did Jesus come and why did Jesus have to die? Why did he have to do that thing to break the power of the enemy? I believe that God wants us to have our eyes opened to understand that there's so much more for us that God has for us to do. So moving in the power of the supernatural of God, I believe is what God wants. Unbelief is the wall that stops the flow of God's supernatural power. I believe that God wants every believer to flow under the unction, under the anointing, in a supernatural flow, live above, not beneath, be able to speak to the mountains that come around our lives. The Bible says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers us out of them all. It would be wonderful if we never had another problem. It would be wonderful if there was never another attack on your life. It'd be wonderful if we just lived through life just a breeze. But unfortunately, things happen. But you see, as a born-again, spirit-filled believer, God wants you and I to understand and know that he has given us authority to stand against the oppressions and the afflictions and the works of the enemy that comes against you to steal from you your joy, your position, and who you are in Christ. To get you believing that you are a loser, to get you believing that things will never change. But when you start to realize that God has anointed us and given us power and authority, that when these afflictions do come, that we can stand and we can speak to those mountains and they will be removed. You see, there's a wall that stands up against us. It's called unbelief. And that wall is that wall that's got to be broken down. Thomas was with Jesus. He saw all the miraculous, but he still doubted. You know, you can be a Christian for 40 years and still have doubt in your heart. You can be a Christian and on fire for God and then still have something come against you and it will steal your joy, it'll steal your victory, and it'll send you into a frenzy and take you away from the purpose and plan of God. How many people know that there needs to be a change in our lives and the way we live? So, Father, I ask you today that by your Spirit, you'd help us today to understand who we really are, what your purpose, what your plan is for our lives. And for that, Father, we'll give you all the purpose. Open our eyes today, Lord. Lord, let the anointing come in and break down the strongholds and the lies and the deceit of the enemy sown into our lives, that we can stand up and be strong, that we can be the church, your people. And for that, we'll give you all the praise and all the glory. I believe there's some things that you and I have to know. You have to know because if you don't know them, the enemy will steal. You must first know that you are a candidate as a born-again, spirit-filled Christian to flow in the supernatural power of God. Only unbelief stops the flow. You've got to know that I'm a candidate. You know, I lived before I was born again. I lived as a man. But something dynamic happened. You can't really understand it because you can't see it in the natural. It's something that you've got to do by faith. But when you get born again, God does something on the inside of you. God somehow or other connects with us. He causes something on the inside to come alive. And it opens up the whole realm of a supernatural power. The presence of God that can come into our lives. You've got to know that I am a candidate. The enemy might say you've been too bad or you've done things wrong or you don't deserve it. You could have a list of excuses, but I want you to know today that you, as a born-again Christian, are a candidate to have the supernatural power of God to flow through your life where you can lay hands on sick people and they will be healed. Friend, I want to tell you that is the purpose of the church. We are not here just to come and sit in a pew, in a seat, or wherever, whatever denomination or fellowship you go to. We're not here just to sit around to listen to somebody spruik and have a message. We're not here just to sing a couple of songs, but we're here to be the church, God's representatives on this earth, to go into all the world, to preach the gospel, lay hands on the sick, cast out devils in Jesus' name. Do you believe that today? That's what the church is for. Friend, I want to tell you, there's got to come a time when that starts to change in our lives. We must know that when Jesus walked on the earth, he walked as a man. He walked as a man. He could never have been tempted by the devil if he was God. The Bible says that God is not a man that he should lie, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. But he is God, amen. God is not a man. But Jesus said, called himself the Son of Man. Jesus came on this planet as a man. He walked as a man. He emptied himself. As Phil was sharing, that he lowered himself. He left glory. He left all that he possessed up there, and he came down here as a man, and he walked as a man. What an amazing thing that God did that. Jesus had one thing, though, that really helped Jesus to walk through life and to do the things that he did. Jesus had no unbelief. Jesus knew his Father. He knew the power of the Holy Spirit. He knew that whatever he asked his Father, he would be able to do it. Yet the Bible tells us that that's what we can do. He says in Mark and different places, whatever you ask in my name, I will do it for you. And yet we sometimes get something on the inside of us called unbelief that just floods on the inside. And this word of God that comes and says, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you, or you are more than a conqueror, or whatever it might be, that it sort of hits that wall of unbelief and stops it from entering into us. Friend, we've got to remove those things. Those songs there, those barriers, those walls have to come down. They've got to be broken. They've got to be smashed so as that we can have an open heaven and that the power of God can flow into our lives. And we as Christians can operate in the power and the authority that God has freely given to us. Unbelief is the wall that stops it. Unbelief will stop us from flowing in that dynamic power. Jesus had no unbelief in him. He knew his Father. Oh, Father, help us to know you. Amen. Help us to know that we live under an open heaven. So Jesus had great confidence. When Jesus stood in the synagogue that day and he quoted Isaiah 61, 1 and 2, and it's also Luke 4, 18. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. God has anointed me. He spoke it with confidence. He spoke it with something on the inside of him that he just knew that God had raised him up. Friend, today we have to understand that same Spirit, that same God, today wants to raise up his church, wants to raise up his people. And we, as representatives of Jesus today, are to do exactly what Jesus did. I want to just open up the scriptures there to the book of Luke. And just have a look at that, because it's so important, I believe, for us to see it and to understand it and realize it. And it'll be up on the screen in a few seconds there. Luke chapter 4, awesome scriptures here, how God anointed Jesus, touched him mightily. It says in verse 14 there, chapter 4, then Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and news of him went out. And he went in after a while in verse 18, and he stood up there and he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because God has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to claim the acceptable year of the Lord. He closed the book and then after a while he said, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. And this Jesus, as he spoke those words, there was a confidence in him. There was a confidence. And I saw that confidence in John as he called people out, and people there that came with obviously great pain and in great discomfort. But there was something there. There was a tenacity on the inside of him that started to stir again in me. Friend, I want to tell you, we've got to start to stir again. We've got to allow the stirring of the Spirit. We've got to let that gift that God has put in us to stir again, that will cause us to rise and to break off the lethargies and break off the unbelief and the hardness of heart and the things that get around us so easily, because we live in this world and the onslaught of the enemy, his purpose and his plan is to try to stop the church from becoming the church. And he doesn't care if we're just a bunch of hymn singers or a bunch of pew warmers or a bunch of people there that might even pray a bit and read your Bible a bit. But I want to tell you, Jesus wants a mighty army to begin to rise. He wants to see his church stand up with all its power and all its glory, to be clothed in that anointing, to be clothed with the power of God, to go forth to do exactly what Jesus said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because God has anointed me to preach, to set at liberty those who are bound, to set the captives free, to heal those who are oppressed of the devil. Friend, that's why we're on this planet. That's why the church is here, for no other reason but to do that. Do you believe that today? So Jesus, with great confidence, when he stood in that synagogue and he started to quote those words, he understood that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him. What a great thing it would be every morning if we jumped out of bed and threw our hands in the air and started to cry out, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. God has anointed me. And walk through life with a confidence, knowing that God has, whatever God has said, he's able to do. And when God says to you that whatever you ask in my name, I will do it for you. If somehow or other we had a confidence on the inside of us that knew that whatever we asked God, God would do it for us. Amen. And not try to pray it or believe it through unbelief and negativity and hope, but to have a confidence. Oh, God, restore to us again our confidence. Amen. Our confidence in this word, our confidence in what you say you can do and you will do. So it's great confidence. I believe the next move of God must be and will be a reassurance of the miraculous flow of God accompanied by signs and wonders. I believe that this next move is going to be something there so dynamic and so powerful. Let's have a look at what God says about you. About you. You know, sometimes we just read all about Jesus and we read all about this, but what does the Bible say about you? I want you to have a look with me in the book of Mark, chapter 16. Is it all right to read from the Bible? Later he appeared to the 11 as they sat at the table. This is 16, verse 14. And he rebuked their unbelief and hardness of heart because they did not believe those who had seen him after he was risen. Unbelief is a curse. Unbelief is something there that these people that were with Jesus, yet they still suffered it. And I want to tell you today, it's at plague proportion in the church. We've got to smash it somehow or other. We've got to break it somehow or other. You've got to grit your teeth sometimes to do some things. You've got to believe God, to put your trust in God, to be able to break the stranglehold that the enemy has over our lives caused by unbelief. These disciples had unbelief in their lives. Thomas had unbelief, but praise God, he changed. Amen. There's room. How many people say, I need to change? I need to change some things. And he said that they had unbelief and hardness of heart because they did not believe. And he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will follow those who believe in my name. This is talking about you. This is what he's saying. He said, you go out there. You go out there and you preach the gospel. You go out there and speak this word. And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. If they take up serpents or drink any deadly thing, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. So then, after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. Friend, if you had your last few words with somebody, you wouldn't be telling them something there, some fairy tale. You'd be telling them something that was so really, really important, something that was so, so relevant, something that was so much a part of God, something that was so much a part of Jesus, something, the message that he wanted to get out to the people, something there that it was so important to him that it was the last things he was going to say to his disciples before he was taken up into heaven. And he started to say these things, man, go out there and preach the gospel and call them in, and whoever believes will be saved. If they don't believe, they'll be condemned. And tell the Chrises of this world, tell the Roys of this world, tell whoever in this world will listen to them. If they believe, they can go out and lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Hallelujah. They will cast out devils in my name. If they drink any deadly thing, if anything, the devil tries to put anything on you, it will by no means harm you, because greater is he who is within you than he that's within the world. And I'm going to raise up a great army of people, an army of believers. Hallelujah. He's going to raise up a great army. They're so, so important to him. And these guys, it says that they got up and they went and they did what God did. And the Bible says then that God confirmed the word by healing the sick in Jesus' name. Amen. What an amazing thing. Let me just read it to you, because I've actually got that messed up a little bit. So then, after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere. Can I say this, friends? I don't believe that God just wants you to go out there and get some great sermon or something like that. He wants you to go out there and give your testimony. He wants you to go out there and tell people how good God is. He wants, because the world out there, they don't know God's a good God. They think that if something falls out of the sky and kills 100 people, it's an act of God. It is not an act of God, amen. Our God is a good God. Do you believe that today? He is an awesome God. He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. We need to be able to go out there and say, I was lost, but now I am found. You go out there and say, man, I struggle with this and I struggle with that, but Jesus came into my life and he set me free. I don't know if people are wondering about heaven and things like that. I know what they want. They want to know, how can I live in victory right now on this planet? How can I get rid of this monkey that's on my back? How can I get rid of this cursed thing that follows me and hounds me and torments me and brings me into depression and brokenness and goodness knows what? How can I live free? I want to tell you, Jesus said, you will know the truth and the truth will make you free. But it's going to take a bit of grit, and it's going to take a bit of determination, and it's going to take a bit of standing up, and it's going to take a little bit of saying no to the devil and yes to God. That's what's going to change society. That's what's going to change our world. That's what's going to change. I'm going to tell you, oh, Mr. Trump's getting himself into a lot of trouble, but I tell you what, he's saying some things, amen. These signs will follow them that believe. It doesn't say these signs will follow pastors. Doesn't say these signs will follow evangelists or teachers. But it says them. Whoever's a them. If you're a them, will you put up your hand right now? These signs will follow them that believe in my name. John 14, 12 says, verily, verily, I say to you, these things that I do, you shall do also, and even greater things than this shall, who do? You do. That was good, wasn't it? That got your attention. Thought I said voodoo. No, you do. You do. These things that I do, you can do also. What an amazing invitation that is. Would Jesus be trying to con us? Would he be trying to trick us? No, he knows what's available to us. He knows what we can do. He knows that these things are there for us, but he also knows that the enemy, because he was talking to his disciples who are full of unbelief and hardness of heart. And friend, I pray today that the Holy Spirit will get hold of us and shake us a little bit and get rid of that brokenness that's in our life and our unbelief and goodness knows what, so that we can hear the word of the Lord, hear what God's saying in this hour. Verily, verily, I say to you, these things that I do, you can do also. There is no doubt that God wants all his children to flow in the supernatural with signs and wonders. There's no doubt Satan wants to stop that flow. Satan doesn't want you to flow in the Holy Ghost. He doesn't mind. You know, he doesn't even mind. He can even come to church and enjoy church if they're not doing anything. I don't think he would enjoy here too much. The devil doesn't want you to know it because he knows you will destroy his plans. He's got a plan for society. He's got a plan for Australia, and that's to destroy it. In Jesus' name, you will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. You will cast out demons. The devil doesn't want that. He doesn't want you casting out devils. God, through his word, has made it plain again and again that his power and gifts are not for a select few, but for all who believes what the Bible says. Are we Bible believers here? Do we believe the word of God? Can I suggest to you that you start reading the Gospels again? Read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Read those Gospels again. Get a glimpse of Jesus. You know, one of the things there is in Revelations, as they were going through the churches, it said to the churches there, it says, all these good things about him. He said, but there's one thing I've got against you. You've lost your first love. And you know, it's very interesting that to understand that there's things there that we can lose. And I know in my own heart and in my own life, as I start to read again the Gospels, as I start to read about Jesus, how he walked through this life, how he saw a woman that had been caught in adultery, and instead of accusing her and instead of demanding the death penalty, he loved on her. There's one thing that we cannot comprehend sometimes is God's love. God's miraculous love. And you start to look at this Jesus and you start to fall in love with him all over and over again. I remember singing that song, I keep falling in love with him over and over. Friend, I want to tell you, the church has got to fall in love with Jesus again. Come on, we've got to fall in love with Jesus. Amen. We're going to fall. If you're looking in through the eyes of the church and you're just looking at the church, all you see is mess. As we look at the news the other night, they're bringing all the cardinals from the different churches, the different Catholic churches and that, and they're going to have to stand up there and they're going to have to talk about the atrocities that were done to the young people, rapes and goodness knows what else. That's how people see the church, friends. But I want to tell you, the church that Jesus wants has got to be seen again, amen. And somehow or other, if we've got to stir ourselves again, when we're singing the songs of praise, man, throw your hands in the air. I don't care what people think about me. I could not care less about what you think. It's what Jesus thinks is all the matter, amen. And if we can just throw our hands in the air and say, Jesus, I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. Why don't you do that for a minute right now? Just throw your hands up in the air and tell Jesus how much you love him. Oh, we love you, Jesus. We love you. We love you. We love you. You're our God and we will praise you. Hallelujah. We love you. 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 What an amazing God we serve. What an amazing God. This Jesus, this devil hates us. Start reading the Gospels again. Read through them. Look, have a good look at Jesus. Look at him again and again. Get a glimpse of Jesus. Here he was healing the sick. Man, there was times there when he would have been totally exhausted. Times there when he went aside to try to get away a little bit, but the crowd thronged him. Then what did he do? Did he send him? No, he went in there and he said he healed all. You see him healing the sick. You see him casting out demons. You see him going into the different places where nobody really wanted him, but he kept on going in there and loving on them. Went in there and set captives free. I don't know about you if you've never ever seen a captive that's been set free, but have a look at this one. Hallelujah. Amen. Have a look at the one beside you and have a look at yourself in the mirror and look at yourself and say, I'm a captive that's been set free. Hallelujah. I am a captive that's been set free. He didn't set you free to become some religious fruitcake. He set you free to be everything that He wants you to be a child of God, to be a child of God. Amen. There He was, healing the sick, casting out devils, setting captives free, building His church. But friend, I got good news for you. It's our turn now. Amen. Now it's our turn. He, Jesus, has given us everything that we need. So just go out and do it. I want to encourage you, friends, get hold of the Bible. Read the Gospels. Get hold of the book of Acts. Read the book of Acts. Get the Spirit of God inside you. I believe Jesus is looking for people who will rise up and trust in the power of His Spirit. I believe Jesus is waiting for you. I believe Jesus is waiting for us. I believe that the Bible speaks about that we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. I believe that these witnesses, the Abrahams and the Isaacs and all the different ones, all the apostles, all the disciples, the Catherine Kuhlmans, the different Finneys and all the ones there that have carried the fire. People that carried the fire of God, that kept the fire burning. Friend, I want to be a man that keeps the fire burning. Amen. I want to be known like that. Amen. But to keep the fire burning. I believe that we're surrounded by so great a crowd of witnesses and the people there that are up there and through the portals of glory as they're looking down, as they're watching, and they're seeing a bunch of people that are beginning to stir, that something's happening, that the fire of God's getting on the inside of them. They're falling in love with Jesus again. They're not conscious of their own self. They're just conscious of the mission. They're conscious of what God has in store for us, and they want to be a pleaser of God more than a pleaser of man. There's a stirring, and I can almost hear a shout beginning to stir up there as they're starting to shout, as a murmur saying, hey, there's a bunch of people down there. They're over here in Africa. They're over here in America. They're over here in Australia, in New Zealand, different parts of the world. There's a stirring going on. There's a bunch of people that are beginning to rise. There's a sound coming out, and there's a roar that starts to go out from all those saints in glory saying, yes, this is the hour that we've been living for. This is what we've been looking for, the church. On earth, victorious, triumphant, overcoming the devil, amen. Destroying his works, that's who we are. That's what we're here for, no other reason. I believe this is what Jesus is looking for. I believe that this is what Jesus is waiting for. You must believe that you are a person who God says you are. Don't listen to what somebody else says you are. Listen to what God says you are. What does God say you are? Come on, anybody know what God says you are? Let me start you off. You are more than a conqueror. Yeah. Anybody else got anything you want to add to that? Greater is He that's within me than he that's within the world. Anybody else got anything? I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I'm a healer. Hallelujah. That's true. The joy of the Lord is my strength. Anybody else quickly? One more. I'm a world overcomer because I'm born of Him. I am complete in Him. Look at me, Nancy. I am complete. In him, yeah. Listen here. You must know who you are in the sight of God, in the sight of man, and in the sight of the devil. You've got to know who you are in the sight of God. You know who I am in sight of God? I'm a chosen generation. I am His masterpiece. Yeah. Excuse me. This is a pull a few things up where they should be. That's why lifesavers don't talk on the beach. Because they can't talk when they're off their stomach. We got to know who you are before God, before man, and before the devil. It was? You're the head, not the tail. That's true. That's who we are. Remember those sons of Ziva? Skeva, yeah. That's who I was talking about, yeah. He said, Jesus I know, Paul I know, but who are you? I don't want him saying, who are you? I want him saying, you're Neil. Yes. Amen? Yes. You're Fred. You're Jack. You're John. I'm getting away from you. So, anyhow, you've got to know who you are before God, before man, and before the devil. God knows far more about you than you do yourself. You know what? God knows the potential that's in you. He knows the potential. You might not see it, but you got to look in the mirror and say, man, you got potential. I would rather come into agreement with God than the devil, amen? You laugh at me, but you've got to stand in the mirror and look at yourself eyeball to eyeball and say, you got potential. Hey? You're laughing at me. You're terrible people. I want you to turn to me, look at me and say, I got potential. You're not saying that. You're not convincing me one bit. Hey, come on. You got potential? You got to have potential, amen. Anyhow, Father, we just thank you. We do have potential. My God, we are a mystery parcel. There's so much inside of us that's got to be discovered by us. You know who we are. You know what we're capable of doing. And so does the devil. And he'll do whatever he can to stop us from being who you want us to be. So Lord, today we're just asking you to come and help us to realize the potential that's on the inside of us, the great power of God. And here we are, as Phil was saying, we're seated with you in heavenly places, far above principalities and powers and dominion and might. My God, we just want to stir ourselves again today in Jesus' name. And Father, we just give you all the praise and give you all the glory. Amen. Musicians are going to come and we're going to sing that Victor one. We did the Victor one. Is that all right? Hey, folks, if you're here today and you might need a touch in your body, tonight we're just going to really, I just want to spend time worshiping Jesus tonight. And then just allow the anointing to flow. And now allow the anointing to flow and touch people. Amen. Friend, there's two things that I believe that we've got to do. We need to connect again with God. Connect again and have an encounter with Him. Connect and have an encounter. And tonight we'll be just believing for that to happen. So come along and be part of it. Let's believe God. If you've got some friends that need the healing and whatever it is, we'll just pray for that. But let's just stand to our feet right now. We're just going to sing that Victor song. This morning, we might not pray for anybody, but you might want to say, I want to break free from me. Does that make sense? I want to break free from me. Because see, you've been fashioned and molded by circumstances and situations and hurts and brokenness, disappointment. And so it's sort of fashioned something. And sometimes we're locked into that. But I want to be set free from that so I can be. And you might just want to come and stand out here in the presence of God and just say, that's me. I want to be free. Just feel free to do that. We might pray for you. I don't know. We'll just see. Let's just see what God does. Amen.